गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड आफ्टरनून एंड वेलकम टू दिस वेबिनार ऑन रीसेंट अमेंडमेंट्स इन कंपनीज एक्ट. आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस इम्पोर्टेंट वेबिनार विच इज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय द इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ कंपनी सेक्रेटरीज ऑफ इंडिया. दिस पर्टिकुलर वेबिनार्स आर यूजुअली ऑर्गेनाइज्ड फॉर टू इम्पोर्टेंट पर्पजेज. वन इज फॉर नॉलेज शेयरिंग and another which is very close to the members of our institute, that is program credit hours. So this webinar will provide both the things to all our members. As we initially started, this COVID situation is a really unexpected situation with institute also. Institute was also not 100% ready with what we should do and what can be done during this COVID period. And we were also not sure how to go about the use of technology in this COVID period. That is why initially we started the webinars with a limited number of members. With limited number of members, we started the first seminar wherein 3,000 members were allowed to be logged in, and there were a lot of reservations from the members, and members really said that they want more number of people in the webinar. So we again then went back to our IT team. IT team then worked on having a separate session, a separate type of software for having unlimited number of members. Then we tried for 20,000. The 20,000 members webinar was not a very successful one because of the failure of the some broadband issues at the vendor's place. And then we again tried the same thing, but last Monday we had planned this particular webinar only, wherein we were supposed to have unlimited members, but due to issues with the software, we received the directions that we are not supposed to use that particular software because of the bombing issue and because of some issues with that software. So we have discontinued that software. Institute has already given a direction that we should not use that particular software, and therefore we are now we have moved into the new software wherein we can have the unlimited number of members who can log in and whose PCH can be recorded. We had a testing for last two webinars wherein around 17,000 and 15,000 members were logged in, and even though it was not with PCH, still a lot of members could take benefit of that particular webinar through this system. And that is why now we are confident that we will not be having any problem with this particular software, and that is why we are now launching this particular webinar with program credit hours. While discussing about program credit hours, let me tell you that Institute in December itself have come out with a scheme that not only physical attendance but also with other means you can obtain your program credit hours. The webinar is one of the part of it, plus there are post membership qualification courses, PMQ courses in short, which we always talk about. So PMQ courses are there to which you can appear, and you can get the program credit hours. Plus, Institute has come out with a scheme wherein six kinds of exams or tests can be appeared by the members, and they can get 10 program credit hours for each of the module which they appear. So that is one option which is available with the members to complete their program credit hours. This 2017 to 2020 is the block which is getting over now, and that is why, and which has already been extended to 30th June for the benefit of all the members. Still, Institute is trying its level best to provide you best of the facilities. Even you also should appreciate the efforts of our president. He is trying to communicate with all the members, all the students. There is a continuous process wherein we are trying to improve the services at ICSI level. There are three type of stakeholders in Institute. One is our students, second our members, and the regulatory authority. So when we discussed about this COVID issue and everything under lockdown, first thing we thought that we should concentrate on students. So for students, we have already started all online courses. The oral tuition classes of almost all the chapters is running into online mode, and it is now very smooth for them. Then for members, we already started conducting webinars, but there were few limitations, so we could not get through what we wanted to do it. But now we are on track, I believe, and today's webinar will let us know whether we are on track and whether we are successful. So soon we will get to know today that whether we are on track in respect of members. But in addition to that, I would like to inform you that we are now coming out with four different types of short-term certificate online courses, which will be conducted by ICSI during this lockdown period. And most probably it will start from 25th of this month. And we are going to organize first four of such certificate courses on different topics. The topics are also being finalized, and you will receive an email in respect of that today itself. So we are going to have one certificate course on security laws, another certificate course on IPR. Third is on IT, using of IT tools, and fourth one is on arbitration. So these four we are launching, and we will be launching it today or or tomorrow, and the actual courses will start from 25th. The modus operandi will be there will be online classes, and after online classes there will be assessment test, and after assessment test a certificate of certificate will be issued by the institute to all the members, and these are exclusively for members and not for the other members or students also, other public and students. It is not available for them. It is only exclusively for our members, and this also carries a program credit hours. So you will be able to get the program credit hours also. So therefore we are trying our level best, because the faculty and moderator are at two different places. The IT guy is sitting somewhere in Delhi. So we are trying to coordinate all three and giving you the best possible experience of these webinars. That is why there might be some technical issues. So you as part of our institute, and it is your institute, so I hope that you all will coordinate with us, cooperate with us, and will support us. And your feedbacks are always welcome, and we at council, under the able leadership of our president, we always believe in having proper feedbacks, good feedbacks, positive, negative it might be, and we work on all kinds of feedbacks, even criticism. So it is always welcome, and your feedbacks in such a difficult period will definitely help our profession to grow further. Now let's come back to the topic for which today's seminar has been organized. We have got Dr. C.S. D.K. Jain from Indore. I welcome him to this particular webinar. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation for being a faculty for this seminar. And he would be conducting the session on recent changes. So he has taken out changes effective from 1st January 2020, and he will be guiding us and discussing various practical aspects of the changes which have happened since 1st January in rules by way of circular. You all know that the CFSS scheme is in force. Then there are a lot of changes which happened. I always believe before, even maybe 6 months or 7 months before, I thought that Facebook was the site which gets updated pretty quickly. But now I have changed my mind, and I think that MCA 21 is the website which gets more updates than even my Facebook page. So there are a lot of changes which are happening in corporate laws. To understand and to keep a track of such changes, we have CS DK Jain from Indore, who would be discussing our matters, all these matters. And I welcome him on behalf of ICSI and request him to please continue to just give a brief introduction. He is a practicing company secretary, he is a registered valuer, and he is an insolvency professional also. So all three different dynamic areas he is handling. So we will be able to discuss various practical aspects with him. So sir, over to you. Thank you very much for joining. I'm there and I'll be discussing various points with you during the session, sir.
Thank you, Devan ji. I am very much thankful to the institute for providing me the opportunity to address my professional friends on the very encouraging and dynamic topic, recent changes in the Companies Act. As you are aware that the year 2020 is the year for change in the lifestyle even.
Sir, video is not visible.
Hello.
Video is off. Video off.
Hello. Is the change of lifestyle? We could not even thought about that we would be kept in the home for unlimited period. Already, I think more than 28 days is over, and in place of Indore where we are sitting, we are not aware whether we would be able to come out on 3rd May or not, because everybody is knowing that Indore is facing severe constraint of corona threats. More than 900 people are identified, and Indore has been taken as a hotspot city of India. Anyway, this is an opportunity to learn something. It is new thing to consider. We never thought that we would be at home. We will not be having any facility to move anywhere. We have never thought that we would be able to concentrate in our study and to update ourselves in such a manner that we are having almost 4 to 5 hours webinar daily so that we can update ourselves. And thanks to Devanji for moderating the program. Thanks to the ICSI, thanks to my president Ashish Garji to organize this program. Actually, it was supposed to be held on 11th, but due to technical reason, as already told by Devanji, it has to be postponed. And it's everything, whatever is done, gives some good results. So I think due to some reasons, now we are capable, are able to provide our webinar on the topic, recent changes in the Companies Act 2013. I have covered this topic for changes from 1st Jan to till now. And it can be categorized in a three sector. Number one, changes by way of circulars. Number two, by way of amendment in various rules under the Companies Act. And number three, by way of notifications. In addition to that, there is also a bill proposed by or approved by the cabinet for companies amendment bill, which is to be placed before the parliament. Might be possible that it may have status of ordinance, so that another changes is to, and we are not aware of what is to cover. And during the period I am talking about the changes, basically each and every item has already been taken over during the last month, during the last 30 days of the period of COVID, like CFSS scheme, like webinar held by Sudhakar sir for passing of ordinary and special edition through video and other wise then audio video mode, changes in the amendment in the Companies Act by way of bill to be passed, bill already passed by the cabinet, and various topics has already been covered. So that I think that it is a time to consolidate all the changes made from January to till now, so that we may be able to organize our events when we are in a position to come to our office and streamline our all the pendency, because we are not able to work properly for a period about, I think in case of Mumbai or big cities, from 20 5th March almost, we are not able to work. And whenever we will go to our office, there will be great pressure to complete all the pendencies as well as continue working. We are supposed to, in case of we are having a state company, we are supposed to comply with the requirement of listing agreement. For which in most of the cases, 1 month has already been extended by the SEBI and stock exchanges through relaxation. Company, it has also provided so many opportunities for considering the various problems of the professionals by way of moratorium and other circulars. Therefore, we need to organize ourselves, our working, our clients, our corporates, our stakeholders, so that we would be able to work and satisfy the requirement of law as well as requirement of all the stakeholders. Now I would like to share my PPT, which is already
you can share the screen, sir.
Yeah. First, I will start from changes made under the Companies Act by way of circulars, and I'm starting from current to past. Means from today to January, 1st
January 2020. Yes, sir.
Yes.
You can continue. It's visible.
The first session is for circular issued by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs from 1st January to till now. The latest circular is circular number 17, dated 13th April 2020. It is in continuation of circular number 14 of 8th April. It is relating to the passing of ordinary and special resolution on urgent nature during the period of 8th April 2020 to 30th June 2020 by members other than ordinary businesses. Ordinary business, we are aware what is ordinary business, like approval of accounts or adoption of accounts in general meeting, declaration of dividend, reappointment of auditor, reappointment of directors liable to retire by rotation. These are the ordinary business. Or where a person has right to be heard during the meeting, that can be categorized like removal of auditor. Auditor is having options to represent himself, or removal of a director. He has right to speak before the meeting. Where physical presence of members at a common venue is required, now it can be through video conferencing or other audio video mode. The topic has already been nicely dealt by previous speaker Sudhakar sir. I will give some more details in next slides. Then circular number 16, it is issued on 13th April. It is relating to filing of forms IEPF 1, IEPF 1A, IEPF 2, IEPF 3, IEPF 4, IEPF 7, and e-verification of form under section 124 and 125 of the Companies Act relating to transfer of unclaimed or unpaid dividend and resulting shares to be transferred to the IEPF authority.
Right.
Members, you are aware that by circular number 11 dated 24th March, as well as circular number 12 dated 30th March, the government has come out with the scheme for moratorium for filing of document for a period of 6 months from 1st April to 30th September, irrespective of date of filing, without filing of document, without additional filing fee, only normal filing fee is suffice. As well as there is a scheme for filing a belated document by defaulting companies. Even though, why there was a requirement to issue a circular number 16 dated 13th April under section 124-125. As all the documents have already been covered by a circular dated 24th March, company was given opportunity to file that document from 1st April to 30th September with the normal filing fee, irrespective of due date of filing. Then there was no need at all. There is only one reason. These documents, every document is required to be filed at the portal of NCA and IEPF 1, IEPF 2, and other document relating to Investor Education and Protection Fund is to be uploaded at the portal of IEPF through the help of MCA. Therefore, the authority is changed. If you go to circular number 11, dated 24, which provides document required to be filed at the portal of MCA, that includes companies as well as LLP. But here, the document is required to be uploaded at the portal of IEPF. Some forms are like web form. Therefore, these circulars have been issued to provide immunity to file the document till 30th September 2020. Then circular number 15 dated 10th April, it is related to COVID-19 related FAQ on CSR. Friends, be aware that the present period is to do something for the society by way of charity personally or by way of charity or otherwise obligation imposed under section 135 of the Companies Act. As a CSR activities to fulfill our social responsibility toward the society under the social responsibility CSR 135 section, read with Schedule 7. Department has considered and issued clarification to provide clarity whether the amount expended by the companies would cover under CSR or not. They have given clarification on 7 items. Number one, PF CARES Fund. Every amount given by a corporate to PF CARES Funds, means Prime Minister CARES Fund, shall be qualified as a CSR expenses. 100% recognized and qualified as a CSR expenses. Another contribution made to CM Relief Fund. CM Relief Fund, Chief Minister Relief Fund or State Relief Fund for COVID-19. However, it is not included in Schedule 7, therefore shall not be eligible to claim as a CSR expenses made by the company. One, if you give to the central government through the Prime Minister CARE Fund, it is eligible. If you give to the CM Relief Fund, State Relief Fund for COVID-19 is not qualified for CSR expenses. But the condition to State Disaster Management Authority to COVID-19 is qualified. What is the logic behind it? I could not understand, but thoroughly, if you go into the CM Relief Fund, CM is having option to use the money otherwise than COVID or State Relief Fund. But if it is for disaster management, if you go to a previous circular, it is COVID-19 or Corona has been specified and notified by the government as a disaster event. Therefore, any amount expended by the company under the item number 12 of Schedule 7, it is considered as a disaster management and eligible for claim under CSR expenses incurred by the company. Item number 4, spending for COVID-related activities. There is two options available with us, either to give to the government by PM Relief Fund, by Disaster Management Fund to the Chief Minister of the state. Okay. If you want to do something at our own end, then related activities which is related to COVID-19 is also considered as an example, as a activities qualified for CSR expenses, which is covered under item number 1 and item number 7 of Schedule Further, as you are aware that there is a problem for employment, payment made to salary and wages to the employee, including contract labor, during lockdown period, we are not capable to work since 22nd when Janta curfew was announced by the government. Thereafter, the disturbance, people go to their hometowns and so many problems are there. Factories were not working, companies, offices, and even our offices are not working. Then any amount paid to salary, wages, to employee and worker, including contract labor during lockdown period, cannot be adjusted in CSR. We cannot say that we are paying remuneration or salary to our employee. Then it is expenses. It is for their betterment. No. Basically, if you consider, if you go to the particular, any amount expended toward your employee is not a CSR. Therefore, if you pay any salary to our employee for the lockdown period, cannot be considered. It's very simple and easy. Another, payment of wages to temporary worker, including casual labor in case of factories, there is a system to occupy temporary worker on need basis. If they are not on particular payroll, they are called. They are occupied and paid on a temporary basis or a casual worker. This cannot be adjusted against CSR. It is your responsibility. If you are running the factory, then you have to pay. Then there is no matter that you have not done anything for society as a whole. It is only for the purpose of running your business activities in the ordinary course of business. However, the ex gratia payment to temporary and casual workers over and above their normal wages. Over and above means whatever your salary is, it is at 15,000 or 20,000 per month. Okay, you are paying 15,000 per month, 1 month extra salary to employ to cover the expenses as a COVID fighting. The additional amount paid by you, paid by the company to temporary and casual worker, in addition to normal salary and wages, shall be qualified as a CSR expenses subject to. You provide. Yes.
Yes. Sir, there were two important questions in respect of this particular circular. There were a few questions asked by our members. What is the validity of this FAQ issued, and whether because in earlier circular, MC has said that it will be you will have to take a liberalized view, and now they have come up with certain contributions which will not qualify as a CSR. So the amount spent by a corporate between the earlier circular and this circular, whether that will fall into CSR or not is something which people are asking. So if you can clarify that, what is the validity of this FAQ, and this is applicable to all the corporates, and how to deal with this particular interpretation issue, sir. So if you can clarify, that will be helpful for all the members to understand.
Devanji, the circular issued, yes, to clarify, it is the nature of FAQ, frequently asked questions, because the various investors, various stakeholders have approached the government seeking clarification on what to do, how to make contribution, whether we are eligible, whether we, if we expend amount, will be eligible for CSR expenses or not. So government considered all this type of questions and made a general answer, which is called a frequently asked question. And government is also considered that the view given by the whatever given under schedule should be taken as a liberalized view. In 2014 circular, it says circular number, I think it was 8 or 13 some circular. And recently in March, they were also considered that they should be considered a liberal view, not a particular. There is a separate circular issued by the MCA in March specifying what activities can be covered under the CSR expenses related to COVID issue. So that every circular issued by the department is having some force for the department itself. It is binding on the department. It is not binding on the court or the third person, but every circular issued by the department is binding on the department, their officer as a whole. They cannot deny whatever they committed through the circulars. So I think it is clear to you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ex gratia payment made to employee, ex gratia in addition to normal salary and wages. However, it should be kept in mind, should not be considered as advance bonus is given to the employee, because bonus act is a mistake. It is a separate. If you pay 1 month additional salary based on the salary structure of the employee, or 15 days salary, or 2 months salary, whatever you decide in your company, that can be considered as an ex gratia to fight against the COVID and will be admissible expenses for CSR, subject to you provide a report to the board and provide a certificate from the chartered accountant or auditors of the company that these expenses have been incurred and is eligible under the CSR expense. Okay, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. And go ahead.
Then circular number 13. Basically, I'm talking about the company like amendment made in the Companies Act, however. 14. However, LLP settlement scheme 2020 has already been issued by the department on 4th March. That has been modified by circular number 13, dated 30th March 2020, which provide, as far as we will see in the next slide, for a scheme announced by the MCA, companies thrash start scheme. First thing, agar, if you see, the first time I am in practice since last more than 25 years, and before that I was reading, there was none of the scheme available are issued by this department so far. I think we can relate with the 1956. So far, which provide immunity without paying any penalty. You just come out, pay normal filing fee, and go scot-free. When company is considered for that purpose, one of the reason is to COVID. COVID issue is also one of the reason to provide immunity without any filing fee, without any late filing fee or additional filing fee. Then department also consider why this benefit should not be given to LLP. LLP is also part of the corporate culture. So that this scheme was came on 4th March and it was modified on 30th March. The scheme first initially come out has been, the scheme was announced on 4th March. It was effective on 16th March and nothing could be done till 31st March, as I understand. So that government has not withdrawn that circular, but it has modified the circular, and para number 8 of the circular has been modified by way of insertion of new para again, 8A, which provide that the scheme, now its scheme can be considered in a two-part. Part 1 is for a period of 16 March to 31st March 2020. At that time, there was a requirement to pay additional filing fee. As you are aware that in case of LLP, any document which could not be filed within the due date was liable to pay not less than rupees 100 per day during the period of default. It was the first time when the LLP Act was introduced, the provision was there. Under Companies Act, Section 403 was amended after 2013 Act, but it was in 2010, every document which could not be filed within the stipulated time is liable to pay with the additional fee of rupees 100 per day and to provide immunity from filing fee, relaxation in filing fee. Government considered that in case of default made by the company LLP, this can be filed with the additional filing fee of rupees 10 per day, but subject to maximum 5,000. The scheme now is into operating in two parts. First part is already over. 31st March is over. Then the LLP who has opted the scheme during the period of 16th March to 31st March, I don't think somebody may be there because at that time already lockdown was in process. 25th and onward, full lockdown, and previously there was no such type of activities. Therefore, first part, I think it was not operative at all, so that they have not changed this part, except that. And 8A has been introduced on 30th March, it was a specific effect of COVID, which provided you need not to pay any additional filing fee, any. Just file normal filing fee for form number 3, form number 4, form number 8, form number 11, and other document, if any, is required to be filed by the LLP. can be filed without any filing fee, additional filing fee. However, these cannot be made applicable or benefit cannot be availed by a LLP who has filed application for strike of their name in the form number LLP 20. Here, Devanji.
Yes, sir. There were few queries from the members that few companies have filed all their earlier returns in the first week of March. So what will happen to their additional fees? So we are very much sure that there is no refund procedure for this particular thing.
Issues like that. कि डरपोक आदमी होता है, हिंदी में बोल दूं थोड़ा सा अच्छा लगेगा, मन से निकलता है. जो 100% compliant, they are already suffering. They are those person who have benefited the scheme during the period of 16th March to 30th March, they have paid 10 rupees per day, will not be refunded. If they could not file that, they will get benefit of rupees without any additional filing. We are filing, paying filing fee, even 5,000, they have paid for regular of directors, gone. But now you need not to pay anything. Anyway, government has to provide opportunity again and again and again. And this time they are trying to fresh start. Name of the scheme given as a fresh start, not a settlement scheme. It is not a settlement. It is given an opportunity. कि भाई जो भी कर लिया वापस से अब आके आप तो ठीक हो जाओ. That is a motto. ठीक है. Every time they were, if you remember the earlier days, every 5 to 8 years they are coming with the new scheme, settlement scheme. Sometimes they take this much amount to be paid, additional fee, this much amount to be paid. This time they say nothing to pay, only normal filing fee will suffice. But press start करें, अभी तक जो हो गया ठीक है, इसको normal process पे आ जाए, and now become compliant. Because government already took action, severe action by defund the companies, more than 4 lakh companies have already been defund. And even then the position is not too good. Then they are trying to provide further one opportunity more, and whatever we have already paid can be considered as a contribution given to the government by way of compliance, and nothing would be given as a refund. However, government may consider to provide a certificate for good corporate governance compliance, like income tax department is providing a certificate for good taxpayer, timely taxpayer. Automatic generate certificate is being issued to me. I have also received it. And then we may have such appreciation letter from the department if you could not get our refund fee. Okay.
Sir, whether we feel whether you feel that post this particular scheme, the CMS will be implemented strictly and monitoring system will be strict by the ministry to have the full compliance, because now only fully compliant companies would remain in the system, and this is a good opportunity for non-compliant people to comply and then continue the compliance. So do you feel that MCA will definitely look at this as a measure to clean the earlier part and then start on CMS more strictly?
Yes, Deshpande ji, basic purpose of the government at this time to bring this scheme, fresh start scheme, and to provide amendment in the earlier scheme of LLP settlement scheme is looks like that government want every corporate to come in the scheme to file their related document, and they should not commit any further default. They should first regularize, and they should have it to continue work as per requirement outline to file documents. It is basic concept. So that at this time they are not revenue considering collect fee. It is not their aim to collect filing fee, additional filing fee, or related filing fee. Okay. Just pay normal filing fee, start yourself fresh, and proceed ahead.
Fine, sir. Continue.
As we are talking about Company Stress Start Scheme 2020 CFSS, it is issued under Section 403, 404, 454, 455, and 460. which provided any defaulting company may file belated document during the period from 1st April 2020 to 30th September 2020 with the normal filing fee. If you go to the circular, it says in accordance with the section 403, for which a proviso provided in case of default in filing of form number MGD7 and AOC4, the company will be liable to pay additional filing fee at a rupees 100 per day during the period of default. Section 403 is quoted in the circular. But here they are not asking for any additional filing fee. I think there will be a further clarification in the circular for particular scheme. That particular scheme, they have relaxed the, because section 403 is applicable here. 403 ke saath mein proviso to 403 shall also be applicable and shall be writ together with. Therefore, there is a requirement, but the scheme says there is no requirement to pay any additional filing fee. Then we need to be some further clarification in the scheme. However, no additional filing fee shall be payable, only normal filing fee wherever it is required to be paid. Immunity shall be provided by the designated authority means registrar of companies from prosecution relating to non-filing of documents only. The word is only for default relating to prosecutions. For non-filing of documents shall be provided, other default will not be considered in that purposes, and government is free to prosecute the company and concerning officer who is in default. Okay.
Sir, couple of points in this. I think we can discuss this also, because there are few forms which are required to be filed first, and then they can start the process, like SH8 to be filed for buyback of shares, or MGD14 to be filed for private placement. So there will not be an extension of time for that filing. That is what I believe, and the buyback cannot start before you file SH8, or this private placement offer document cannot go if you don't file MGD14. So that particular relaxation is somewhere missing. That is what I think, and that needs to be represented before MCA. That is what I believe. So.
Definitely, there is a requirement. There are certain issues which needs to be discussed, for which detailed discussion followed. I have given a small letter. So when I come in the particular circular, then I will discuss and reply your queries. Circular number 11, special measure under the Companies Act and LLP in view of COVID issue. That is circular issued on dated 24th, in which the announcement was given by the Honorable Finance Minister along with the Minister for Corporate Affairs, Mr. Anurag Thakur, was available, and it was announced in the first in the television, and then circular was issued. This was basically so many benefit and exemptions and relaxations were provided under the circular by the MCA, which is provided for moratorium for filing of document from 1st April to 30th September, which provided any document, any return statement required to be filed at the portal of MCA 21 by company or LLP irrespective of its due date shall be filed without any additional filing fee. Any document at the portal of MCA which includes LLP, company and LLP, without additional filing fee irrespective of due date of document can be filed with normal filing fee from 1st April, which is already gone, 30th September 2020. Second relaxation was given, one time relaxation to hold board meetings. As you are aware that board meetings, there shall not be gap of more than 120 days between two board meetings. Now 60 days additional time has been given. Now there can be a gap between two board meetings for 180 days till the next two quarters. Next two quarters means here we can consider the circular issued on 24th March. Then first quarter is 30th June. Second quarter is 30th September. This relaxation applicable only for 30th September, not later on. There may be gap of more than up to 180 days, 120 plus 60 days. Okay. Simultaneously, to consider this requirement, SEBI has also released their requirement under the SEBI loader, which provided a quarterly result for the year, for the quarter ended, is required to be approved and filed to the structure within 45 days from the end of the quarter. In case of last quarter, that is March, that is current quarter, which has already been completed, and we need to comply with the requirement. Normal time is 60 days from the end of quarter, means 30th May, not 31st, 30th May is due date. And looking into the particular circumstances in view of the government is also considered, finance minister also considered and provided relaxation for 60 days. Maximum time allowed to 180 days to hold meeting. They also extended the period from 30th May to 30th June. 1 month time is already being given by listed company to comply with the requirement for disclosure of financial results. Okay. The effective date for CARU 2020 has been extended. It was applicable from 1st April 2019, means the balance sheet to be prepared for 31st March 2020 was supposed to be in compliance of CARU 20 order. Now, looking into circumstances, that the corporate are not having proper time, professionals are busy, and they could not comply with the requirement of new requirement of CARU 20. The period has been extended, and now it will be effective from account year commencing from 1st April 2020. It's a good step taken by the finance minister. Non-holding of independent directors meeting, as you are aware that in case of listed company, there is a requirement to have at least one meeting of the independent directors where no executives or management person shall be available to consider and review the performance of the board of directors of the company. And this is required to be disclosed in the board report. Now they consider, in case due to particular reason, distancing, keep distance and lockdown system, if the company could not hold a meeting of independent directors, they could not be considered as violation of particular section. However, they are having opportunity to discuss the matter over telephone or by email. They have also extended the period for deposit, as the company is required to deposit the amount mature due to be matured on 1st April 2021 at least 20% of the amount maturing during the period to a separate bank account, scheduled account. That period has been extended from 30th April to 30th June. 60 days additional time has been given. Similarly, for the amount of debenture likely to be due for redemption, a 50% amount has been extended for 60 days. Time limit for filing of declaration commencement of business has already been extended, has also been extended for a period of further 180 days. As you are aware, this section 10A provided new company, newly incorporated company, which is required to comply with the requirement for taking certificate for comply with the commencement of business requirement, and they need to file a declaration within period of 180 days from the date of their incorporation, that the company is generated funds for subscription amount and has complied with the requirement for disclosure of registered office place, so that they will be eligible to continue the company's business and can carry out business activities of the company. The period was given 180 days from the date of incorporation. Now government is considering further 180 days has been given. One more relaxation given in case of requirement for, there is a requirement at least one director shall be resident in India and another director above more is required to stay in India for a period not less than 182 days. The for this year 1920, if the company is not capable to fulfill the requirement, relaxation has been given and will not be considered as a non-compliance. I will explain the circular in detail in this later slide. Clarification on spending of CSR amount to which COVID fund. I have already discussed earlier that on 23rd March, government has notified there's a COVID-19 as a disaster and spending of CSR fund for COVID-19 is eligible for CSR expenses. Fund may be expended in promotion of healthcare. It is specified here that healthcare, sanitation, and disaster management, if any amount incurred by the company for that purpose, however, it should not be for the purpose of employees of the company only, for the general purposes. If it is for the general purpose, if you say that I have provided lunch to my 150 employees daily, I am providing lunch to them, it will not be considered as a COVID management. If it is provided to general people, it may include your employee. Some of the employee may include, even then it will be considered as a CSR expenses. Sanitation expenses, whatever you want to give, mask, sanitization equipment, PPE kits, whatever you consider, you provide, if you provide it, it would be considered as a CSR expense. Then clarification on, it is very much important circular issued on 2nd May, circular number 5, which provided clarification of prosecution filed or internal adjudication proceeding initiated against the independent directors, non-promoter and non-executive directors and KMPs. No unnecessary civil or criminal proceedings against independent directors, non-promoter directors and NED shall be initiated, and if it is required, guidance may be sought and prosecution should be initiated after receiving due sanction of MCA. That would provide a great help to the independent director to protect themselves in case of non-compliance made by the company, which is required to be complied with the company with the help of their executives and KMPs. If they are not directly involved or directly responsible, they will be excused from the unnecessary wording used as unnecessary civil and criminal proceeding against independent directors. That is a good initiative taken by the government. Circular number 3, dated 30th January 2020, relaxation of additional filing fee and extension of last date for filing of form AOC 4 for NBFC and S companies. The last date was extended till 31st March 2020. Now, as you are aware that there is a relaxation and moratorium period given by the MCA, the period may be considered as 30th September 2020. Another circular number 1, which provides relaxation filing fee on form number BN 2 along with BN 1 to ROC. The time limit for filing of form E-form BN2 is extended up to 31st March 2020 without payment of any additional filing fee. Now, the period may be considered as automatically extended to 30th September due to moratorium period. Now, I am coming to elaborate the circular, some of the circulars which considered to be elaborated specifically for further clarity. For further clarity, in view of, I am taking circular for ordinary and special resolution by company under the Companies Act and rules made thereunder on account of the threats posed by COVID-19. Circular 14, dated 8 April, issued by the MCA, which provided in view of the current extraordinary circumstances due to pandemic caused by COVID-19 prevailing in the country requires social distancing. Therefore, companies are requested to take decision on urgent basis, which could not be avoided by seeking approval of members through postal, e-voting, or otherwise then audio-video system. Then the circular issued is a very typical circular basically, which says that if it cannot be avoided on a very urgent basis, basically if you see, we are not supposed to pass resolution, chalo kar lete hain. फुर्सत नहीं बैठे, चलो चार रेजोल्यूशन पास कर लेते हैं. वी ऑलवेज टेक कंसिडर इन कंसिडरेशन व्हेन इट इज रिक्वायर्ड टू पास द रेजोल्यूशन टू मेक स्पेसिफिक कंप्लायंस ऑफ लॉ, देन देयर इज अ रिक्वायरमेंट टू पास द रेजोल्यूशन. हाउएवर इन सम केसेस इट मे नॉट बी पॉसिबल टू डेफर द मैटर for a period of 3 months or 6 months or till the date of AGM, so that if there is a requirement for urgent basis, then only requirement to conduct AGM arise. Otherwise, matter can be dealt in the AGM. If there is a requirement which cannot be postponed till the date of normal AGM, then there is a requirement to hold AGM. Therefore, each and every item should be considered on urgent basis. However, it can be avoided for certain time. Because these provisions for conducting approval of members in AGM can only be considered if the business is not ordinary business, because ordinary business can be conducted only in AGM, and other than item where the person has right to be heard through mechanism of postal ballot, e-voting without holding a general meeting, which require physical presence of member at a common venue. However, this facility is available only till the period of 30th June 2020. Government considered the date by 30th June, there will be a position normal, and thereafter there will be no problem if physical presence is made at a particular common place. Therefore, the election is given only for a limited period, that is about 81 days only, right? For the particular compliance, the companies have been categorized into two parts. Number one, for listed and other public limited company which required to provide e-voting facility as per requirement of section 108 and 1110, read with the relevant rules. And another type of company is considered as a private limited company or company where there is no requirement to provide such facility. These have been considered. The particular topic has been nicely dealt by my previous speaker, Mr. Sudhakar. Then I think there is no more and much query available on a particular requirement. However, I think there was the webinar was held by Sudhakar is before 30th. Government has issued one more clarification on the particular circular, that is on 13th April 2020 to provide some further clarification regarding there was a requirement in a particular circular to attend meeting through audio video system, and there was a requirement that voting can be by show of hand, which is not practically possible, so that thereafter on 13th April 2020, government has issued some more clarification, which is specifically provided the notice of member may be given only through email, because previously there was requirement to serve notice. A notice to email, those email IDs are registered, and to other by way of speed post. So that if there is no system available, no particular presence is there, then now they have clarified that only email notice communication shall be sufficient, and for the purpose of where we are not having any email address, in case of specifically where the shares are held in physical mode, there may not be having email address. In case of shares held in limited mode, then there must be email address available at the depository or to the registrar and share transfer agent. Then for avoiding this type of particular requirement, they have made clarification. I'm briefly deal with it. There is no need to take consent of members by way of show of hand. If it is required, poll can be conducted, and in case of poll conducting, the email can be given to a particular designated ID by the shareholders for their assent or dissent. Further requirement, if the company is required to provide e-voting facility, they are required to have two-way conferencing system for providing facility to at least 1,000 member on first come first serve basis, excluding large shareholder having more than 2% shares, promoter shareholders, institutional shareholders, independent directors, and auditors. They are required to, they are not counted for the purpose of 1,000 and they are not supposed to first come first serve basis. The facility for joining meeting shall be provided at least 15 minutes before the time schedule start and will close after 15 minutes from the closing of the meeting. Before the HO data meeting, remote e-voting facility has to be provided. We are, in case of listed company, we understand that there is a requirement to provide e-voting facility that must be for a period not less than 3 days, must be closed at least previous day, 5 PM. मतलब अगर मान लीजिए 22 तारीख को मीटिंग होनी है तो 21 तारीख को शाम को 5 बजे ई वोटिंग हैज टू बी कंप्लीटेड. देयर इज अ रिक्वायरमेंट, दिस रिक्वायरमेंट शैल ऑलवेज बी एप्लीकेबल एंड नीड्स टू बी कंप्लाइड. अटेंडेंस ऑफ मेंबर्स थ्रू वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंस, कोरम हैज नॉट बीन रिलैक्स्ड. कोरम इज देयर एज इट वाज देयर इन केस ऑफ public limited company, number of members is up to 1,000, the minimum quorum is 5, up to 1,000 to 5,000, quorum is 15, and 5,000 above, quorum is 13. In case of private limited company, quorum is 2. Then quorum has not been relaxed, basically. Then the presence of members through video conference or other audio video mode has to be counted at the purpose of quorum, and I think in case of e-voting platform, it would not serve any purpose. That can be similar way where we are doing seminar here, webinar here. So Deshpande ji is knowing who is available in the meeting. He is having record. Kin logon ne login kiya hua. On that basis can be considered. There the particular who, how much number of members have attended the meeting. And that has to be taken on record and considered properly. Eligible for waiting, voting. In case of listed company, there is a requirement under the company's e-voting rules which provide that eligible voting shall be on the cutoff date. Cutoff date means 7 days before the date of meeting. Suppose meeting is on 30th, the 23rd shall be date of cutoff meeting, means any member whose name entered in the register member on 23rd shall only be eligible to participate and vote at the meeting. Any person who become member thereafter shall not be eligible. Where there is a less than 15 members at the meeting, the voting may be conducted through e-voting unless demand for poll is made. If demand is made, then requirement of poll is required to be complied as per requirement 6103. Facility for appointment of proxy will not be available here. Because you are not supposed to available here, therefore there is no requirement to send another person to attend on your behalf. You can attend through your own mobile or through your own computer system. Therefore, proxy is not being considered as necessary and no facilities for proxy shall be made available. However, nomination can be given by the appointing person, like if the company is a government company, then President of India or Governor of the state nominate their person, they should be counted as a member personally present at the meeting, as well as in case of corporate, we can appoint their authorized representative by way of board resolution. Their procedure will continue. There will be no stoppage at all. However, proxy will not be allowed.
Okay. Sir, couple of points in this, sir. Because this lockdown may get open on 3rd May or it may get extended, but I think social distancing will continue for a more period, even beyond 30th June. That is what my apprehension or apprehension from many of the members are. And then the annual general meeting also will be coming into picture, and whether this needs to be extended to AGMs as well as whether the time limit of 30th June needs to be extended is a question in the minds of members. The second question which people are talking about is going forward. Now the physical quorum is a bit difficult task for an unlisted company or unlisted public companies, or even for a few of the listed companies. Going forward, whether the e-voting, people who are doing e-voting would be considered as quorum, and any such representation should be done or anything should be done in this regard? What are your views, sir, on this particular points?
I do agree that the particular period, whatever government considered the particular time, was 33 months was supposed to be reasonable, but looking into circumstances which is not certain, the period of lockdown may extend it throughout the country or a specific area of the country like Indore and Ujjain, Bhopal, Mumbai, those having identified hot spots. Therefore, I expect that the government will come out with the particular requirement to extend the period for audio video system of AGM, or may also consider to extend the date of AGM for a particular year, or may provide opportunity to participate through audio video system. Because at this time, government considered 30th June, when it was the circular was issued, it considered the situation will be normalized. If it could not be, then definitely period has to be extended, because as you rightly said, that even lockdown is over, social distancing may be required to maintain for a period about 6 months thereafter to avoid again repetition of particular COVID instance. It's possible to wait and watch. Hopefully, there will be requirement to extend the date by the government and reconsider the matter relating to AGM, because particular this time government has not considered matter relating to AGM through audio-video system. Physical presence is required for the purpose of AGM, but due to certain reason ho sakta hai, jaisa bhi aapne dekha hoga, listed company mein big size company, they are required to hold their AGM by August, 30th August. They may extend the time for a particular this year, because everything whatever government will do on the basis of health of the nation and people of the country. Financial health and physical health, both has to take care thereof. Anyway, sir.
And sir, if the government doesn't come up with such a circular, the companies are anyways open to apply under section 96 for extension of time. And I think ROC, Register of Companies, will take a lenient view on this particular point, I believe.
Definitely, but we are having two set of company. One is listed and another is not listed company. In case of listed company, there is a requirement to comply with the requirement of listing agreement, which provides a specific deadline. And if we seek extension from ROC, that would not suffice for listing compliance. As in case of companies, top 500 company, they are required to comply with the requirement for holding AGM by 30th August, not 30th September. Both the authority will coordinate with each other and synchronize after synchronizing the requirement, as they have already done in case of meeting to be held in year not exceeding 120 days. They have allowed 30 days time more. They will be considered. Hopefully, there may be a mechanism, as you said, in this time government may allow extension for a period of on the basis of application or otherwise. That depends. Yes. Notice of the meeting shall also be prominently displayed on the website of the company as general. Notice for meeting has been served prior to the date of notice. This circular may also come under the particular requirement to hold meeting through audio video system. If we have already issued notice for AGM, and now due to lockdown and social distancing, we may consider and come under the circular after complying with the requirement. The main one thing I observed that all the registration passed in accordance with the mechanism shall be filed with the MGT food ROC within 60 days from the data meeting. Normally, time provided under section 1171 and 179 is 30 days from the date of passing the registration. A registration, only special registration needs to be filed to ROC. Here it says that all the registration, irrespective of ordinary or special, has to be filed to ROC within a period of 60 days instead of 30 days. But form has not been prescribed. So my general presumption is that it should be form number 14. Because in case of EGM, in case of e-voting listed company, there is a requirement to file form or MGT 15 for providing report of e-voting. Here, report of e-voting is not required to file. It says that all registration passed in accordance with the mechanism shall be filed in form number not given. My presumption is that it should be a form number MGT 14. Then time period has been given 60 days instead of 30 days. I think there will be some clarification will be issued by the MCA to clarify what type of form, MGT 14 or MGT 15. My presumption is that it should be form number MGT 14. But why time of 60 days is given if it is 30 days for other purposes? Yes.
Sir, there will be two compliances attached to one general meeting, wherein MGT 14 will go for a special resolution which is passed, plus this particular form, this particular resolution also need to be filed. So in one MGT, if it is MGT 14, then in one MGT 14 you will have to give two portions of one under this circular and one under 117. So I think if it is under MGT 14, there will be two heads which we need to put in the form.
They may make certain amendment in the form MGT 14 field, which may provide option through board meeting, through committee meeting, through general meeting, or through audio video meeting. If it can be provided, then there will be 60 days will be extended by system itself automatically and will allow, because we can file ordinary resolution now. Even there is no restriction, we are not supposed to file, we cannot file. If you want, we can file ordinary resolution through upon, but basic requirement is only applicable for special resolution. We can file definitely. Then option was already available for period has been given 60 days instead of 30 days. So that my question is that there may be amendment in the field of the form which may provide for 60 days time as well as for calculation of filing fee, as well as may give one more option, the meeting conducted through board meeting, committee meeting, general meeting, or audio video meeting, I think.
Right.
Okay. Now, B type company, which is may be considered as a private limited company, are a public limited company not having shares listed in the stock exchange, are not having members of more than 1,000 members, or in case of EOT postal ballot, more than 200 members. These are required to file, provide this facility if they don't want to. They want to pass a resolution through audio video mode as a special and urgent basis. There is almost all the requirements are similar, like two-way conferencing. They need to provide at least access to the meeting for 500 members or number of members, whichever is lower. If company is having 50 members, then there is no need to approach to the authority, to the particular agency, to which are having about 500 members facility. They can provide entire member, whatever number of their, or mean maximum 500 members supposed to be considered to provide opportunity to participate in meeting. By circular number 14 and 8th April, they have issued some clarification regarding the members of a company is holding shares in a physical mode or share held in a demat form but not having email ID. Then how to communicate with them? Because there is no requirement to send notice through speed post or courier. It can be sent only by way of only. What is there is only by way of email. Then they have given some mechanism to contact with them, like publication of notice in newspaper. Additional disclosure is required to be given, a statement of AGM through video conference, other audio video mode is required to be held, date and time of AGM through VCR, OAVM, availability of notice of the meeting on website and stock exchange, manner in which physical holder of shares not having email ID cast their vote and registration, their email ID is very important.
Sir, there is a problem with the audio.
No, sir.
Yeah.
And there is a requirement to give publication in case of listed company or category 1 A company, which is required to publish the notice at least in a one local language and one nationwide circulated English newspaper. And in case of second category company, that is private limited company, they are required to publish in newspaper at least 3 days before the date of sending notice to the members. They are supposed to make contact in case of big type company which are not required to provide the voting facility, to contact to all the members by email or by phone or by other communication to seek their email ID if it is not available and send notice to them. If even a single member is not available to whom you can contact or you are not having contact number, then you need to publish the details in the newspaper at least 3 days before, and you need to provide facility and to communicate and to procure their email ID. That is the requirement. Now, circular number 13, which is LLP settlement scheme. Basically, this scheme is a card as a settlement scheme, but having character of fresh start scheme. Previously, for a period from 16th March to 31st September, there is a requirement. There was a requirement to pay additional filing fee of rupees 10 per day, subject to maximum rupees 5,000 per document, not per company, per LLP. Per document, related document need to file with additional filing fee. Now, after 1st April, as per parent number 8A, there is no requirement to pay any additional filing fee. Only normal filing fee is suffice. The period covered is from the date of incorporation to the date of 30th August. Any document can be filed under the scheme if it is a belated document, right? Defaulting LLP means which could not file any document on the due date. This scheme is applicable till 31st August 2020 from now. Second phase is there. 1st April to 30th September, but belated document till 31st August can only be considered because there will be normal time of 30 days which is provided under the LLP Act to file, and that can be filed in a normal procedure. Payment of fee payable for document, no additional fee shall be payable for filing any belated document under this scheme. Defaulting LLP can file, not subject to any prosecution. Once you file, there will be no prosecution at all. Under this scheme, there is no requirement to seek any immunity by making separate application to ROC. ROC means the rest of LLP. There is no requirement. You file and everything is okay. However, this scheme shall not applicable to LLP who has applied and found our LLP 24 for strike of their name from the rest of LLP. The scheme is very simple. Just file. The name is given as a settlement scheme, but you need not to submit any other document except filing of belated forms. And that can be filed for any number of years. LLP 8 came into 2000, LLP, first LLP registered in 1st April 2009, I think, or 10. Thereafter, each and every document can be filed. Here, aapne theek bola tha Deshpande ji. कितने लोगों ने तो 5-5 साल की 156,000 रुपए की फीस भर दी रिलेटेड डॉक्यूमेंट और फाइल कर जाओ. देयर इज नो रिफंड ऑफ फी. नथिंग कैन बी रिफंडेड वंस यू हैव पेड इज गॉन. इट मे बी फॉर इंक्रीज द थ्रेश कैपिटल, इट मे बी फॉर नॉर्मल कंप्लायंस, इट कैन बी फॉर एनी अदर पर्पस. वंस फी पेड कैन नॉट बी रिटर्न बैक एक्सेप्ट इन केस ऑफ स्टैंप ड्यूटी. देयर इज अ मेकैनिज्म टू रिफंड, टेक रिफंड इफ इट इज रॉन्ग पेड, रॉन्गली पेड. ओके, now circular number 11, opportunity for defaulting company to circular number 12 dated 30th March 2020, in order to give an opportunity to defaulting companies, is a repetition of the scheme and another which provided one time opportunity. Scheme is for one time opportunity, it is also for one time opportunity, both the covering the period from 1st April to 30th September, there is no change. Here we need to consider and file without any requirement to seek immunity or making application. We file and matter is over. And in case of a scheme, fresh start scheme, we need to file and make an application. And application, there is a certain condition to make give application means we have to withdraw our application, if appeal if any file before the department, and some other things we need to consider. There is a restriction on number of file forms like CAG1, CAG4, CAG8, SS7, and other matters. So,
sir, two, three important points in this CFSS, the points which are discussed everywhere. The first point is about MSME one form, because they have given a list of forms to which this scheme will be applicable. I know that MSME one form does not have a filing fee to be paid, but whether the late filing immunity will be like, if we file the form late, not within the stipulated time, then there might be a penalty which might be attached to that particular filing. So whether that also will get immune by this particular scheme, this is question number one. Question number two was in respect of MGT 14. So up to 300 days, yes, we all agree that there will not be any additional fee on MGT 14. And we will be able to file it with normal fees. But after 300 days, whether the condonation process under section 460 has to be done, and then we should come to filing of this particular form. This is question number two. So first we will discuss these two questions, then I have two more. So we can discuss those after your answer, sir.
This question number one is relating to particular form MSME one. Or any other form in which there is no requirement to pay any filing fee, whether this form will be covered under the scheme or not, what I understand. I provide answer like that. If you file any form, as per my previous experience for relating to Gambela settlement scheme and other scheme was available in 2015. There was no option available with you to choose whether this form is particular form is being filed under the scheme or otherwise.
Right.
I think you are experienced.
Yes, yes.
We need to file the form. Basic requirement to file the form, the system will calculate the fee. System will calculate the fee. If form number MSME 1 is filed, there will be no calculation of additional fee. Normal fee, there will be no calculation of additional fee. There is no prescribed penalty under the particular section 403 or 40465 something section is there, which provide no 450, which provide no penalty for non-compliance. But if you go to section 450, which provided in case where there is no penalty is prescribed, the company is liable to pay particular amount to be 500 rupees per day during the period of default. The default is there in due late filing. Even there is no additional filing fee, there is no filing fee. Default is there. Right, sir?
Right, sir.
I think once the scheme is under process from 1st April to 30th September, suppose we need to file our MSME 1 for 30th September, now second MSME 1 for 31st March. Right? And both form could not be filed. We choose to file on 1st September. There is a delay.
Right.
If file the form, there will be no option with us to categorize the form whether it is being filed under the scheme or otherwise. Once we file the form, there will be no filing fee. Zero filing fee will be there. After closing of the scheme period, that is 30th September, we are having 6 months time to seek immunity by filing a separate application for which form has been deployed at the portal of MCA. It would be deployed only on 1st October and thereafter.
Right.
We fill up our SIN number of the company. The form covered under the scheme, and if it is approved by the ROC, will automatically by pre-fill will be available in the portal. Okay, sir?
Yes, sir.
Then we are not having any option to select whether to apply or not to apply. If it is considered under the scheme, we need to file for immunity. If you do not file the immunity, department is having option to collect the additional filing fee.
Right.
Right. If you file, then there will be no option left with the government to collect additional filing fee or to prosecute you because they have provided immunity. So first question is that if it is required, we need to file, and once filed, it will be definitely categorized under the scheme. Even it is not covered under the particular. There is no list given in the form as per annexer which form covered or which not covered. Some of the speakers are providing form, list of 76 form. I think it is copy of the MCA portal. Jitna bhi form dekha sab ko unhone snapshot liya aur total laga 76. It is like that. But no authenticated record is available. Which form is required to be taken under the scheme or which are not required to be taken or which will be considered not to be considered. It is dilemma. Because lockdown period is started, we could not work. Department is also doing the minimum possible or whatever is possible. But I think it will be covered under the scheme. Okay. Now, number two, can you repeat your question again? MGT 14.
It was MGT 14.
MGT 14. And some other forms, you say, buyback of shares without filing, allotment. Preferential shares, before filing of letter of offer, you cannot proceed for issuance later. In case, if it is a right issue, first you need to file letter of offer to the ROC, then you can proceed for right issue. In case of buyback of shares, similarly, you are required to file first letter of offer to the ROC, then only you can proceed for buyback. The second stage application may be delayed, but first is not big. You have filed and you are saying to file, and you have both of them, and buyback is regularized. Or our allotment of share is regularized cannot be the intention of the lawmaker. So certain clarification will definitely come out, and this form, if we file, we may not be considered as a, however, there may be a regulation of additional filing fee may not be taken, but other course of action for prosecution against the defaulting company and director will definitely be there. Another question is, there is a requirement in case of change in object of the company, there is a requirement to file a particular form within a period of 30 days. Otherwise, there is a caution to seek condonation from the regional director or ROC by way of separate application. And without it, the form was not accepting by portal. Now, under this scheme, the form may be accepted. We are not having any experience to file this type of form till now under the particular scheme. Form may be accepted, but department is free to issue show cause notice for adjudication. And otherwise, if it is required, we need to seek condonation of delay. If the form is delayed by 300 days as per requirement of law, and then only should file. Otherwise, if there is no requirement, there is no matter. But because they are not providing, they are providing only immunity to filing fee on account of delayed filing. Not otherwise other
process. Yes. Yes. So, couple of more questions on this particular issue, sir. People are asking that as SEBI has already allowed companies to file their documents with SD, not actual signature, but with SD. And this was a scenario even before 2011, I believe, wherein the director's report and notice of AGM were allowed to be filed with SD converted into PDF. So whether any particular circular or any, whether what would you suggest, whether we should go for it for such a SD filing? And second important thing which we can we need to discuss here is, sir, during this lockdown period, whether the company secretaries in practice should certify any of the digital signature based form, because they are not sure where these forms are signed, who has signed this, all these documents, whether they are real documents or scanned, or whether they are copy paste signatures and all. So what you would suggest to the practicing company secretary, whether they should go for signature of documents and filing these documents under a lockdown situation especially? So what
your first question is relating to whether we can use to document with the marking SD without having signature on the particular form, and SD by making PDF file and attach with the particular form. There is a specific circular issued by the MC which provided SD will not be accepted, only signed copy can be scanned, and we should be legible. Companies having received so-called notice from the ROC in case where only HD form was used, as well as there is a system under the computer which can, you can cut and paste your signature on a particular form. Isko hum log jadoo bolte hain. So that is not acceptable, and prosecution may be launched by the ROC if it is not signed copy of the particular form. HD is not acceptable. A specific circular issued by the ROC in the year 2015. Okay. बैलेंस शीट एंड ओनली साइंड कॉपी शुड बी कन्वर्टेड इन टू पीडीएफ फाइल राइट ओनली साइंड नॉट कंप्यूटर के ऊपर हुआ उसको पीडीएफ में कन्वर्ट करके प्रिंट ऑप्शन दिया इट इज नॉट एक्सेप्टेबल एंड एडवाइजेबल नंबर वन. Your second question was, in the lockdown period, when company secretary is available in his own residence or is not working in the office premises, directors are also locked down, they are not having any digital or personal access to them. Then, in my view, in the digital mode of working, if we do verification of directors KYC. We are doing it. My one of the client has said, Jain sir, lockdown period, I have declared, I have submitted a form, a specific form which is required COVID-19, in which I have said that I am following the lockdown system and not opening office. How can I provide some details to you? सर वेबसाइट के ऊपर तो आप काम कर रहे हैं फोन के ऊपर बात कर रहे हैं मुझे बता दीजिए आपको पासवर्ड नंबर तो देना है कुल मिला करना क्या आपको ओटीपी देना है यू जस्ट प्रोवाइड नो आई विल नॉट प्रोवाइड इट आई एम टोटली लॉक डाउन आई एम नॉट डूइंग एनी वर्क माय पर्सनल व्यू इज दैट वी कैन डेफिनेटली डू इट इफ यू प्रिपेयर अ फाइल वी कैन सेंड इट टू अवर क्लाइंट ही कैन यूज हिज डिजिटल सिग्नेचर वी कैन अपलोड इट अवर ओन ऑफिस आफ्टर वेरिफिकेशन सिग्नेचर एज ए There is no problem at all. There is no restriction to work. Not to work from office. Distancing is required to be maintained. They have not shown, provide any instruction that you cannot work at all. Government is working, sir. MC circular nikal raha hai. Why we cannot?
Yes, sir. Completely agree with you because today even institute has started its offices and as per the home ministry's circular. So we have also started working. See, sir, there were few more questions on this particular point. Like many companies are now asking for audit reports or draft audit reports. So whether what should be done in such a case? Like how a practicing CS should approach the audit and audit related issues and whether they should use IT tools and on the basis of IT tools like virtual data rooms or sharing of documents on drives and etc. Whether they should follow their process of audit and then give the draft report or whether they should say ki we were not able to verify certain documents and then give the audit reports. So if you can guide in a very short this thing. It will be helpful for members.
Devinji, this is a matter relating to personal judgment of the professional. We need to show whatever we are certifying is true and correct, according to best of our knowledge and judgment. We can rely on the document received through email. Definitely, there is no problem. There is no need to physically meet with each other. It can be relied on the basis of document received by email or other electronic mode. And if we are satisfied, we can verify the things. To maximum extent, in case of listed company, there is a requirement to provide certificate of compliance within 60 days from the date of close of the financial year per regulation 24A. Everything is available on the portal of MC itself. We can go there, we can check, we can collect with the document available with the company by the minutes of the board meeting, audit committee, NRC meeting. We can, if you are satisfied, we can definitely do the work. If you are not satisfied, then definitely it is advised not to do the work and take time. There is no hurry at all. Government will consider and provide necessary time if it is not possible at all. As you already said that there may be option ki AGM ki date extend ho jaye. But we are not supposed to make any work which is not verified properly. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yes, we are at a particular scheme which provides for immunity. Basically, there is no option left with us to qualify document whether it is coming under the particular scheme or it is filing otherwise. It is system we take document in particular area. Once document filing is completed, government intention is that we need to file each and every document which is in default. The some question is raised before me by my client, whether we can file the document for a period of 3 years only and rest of the document let it be 10 saal ho gaya company bane ko kuch nahi kiya tha, last 3 saal ki balance sheet file kar di, uska bhi lekha to audit bhi nahi karwaya. Tumhari company strike up kyun nahi hoti, usme charge tha na, isliye strike up nahi ho pai. So my suggestion is that this is the opportunity given by the MCA to pay only normal filing fee. Definitely we should advise to our client and client should understand that it is one time opportunity given by the MCA. It says that it is one time opportunity, then clear all the pendency of the document, whatever it is in your knowledge or whatever you can presume. It should be like that, it should be like that. There might be a requirement to pass a resolution, a special resolution, ordinary resolution, whatever. Do it. It provides an opportunity to professional to work and to generate revenue. It provides freeness to the company from their mindset to prosecute in future for non-compliance or any of the requirement of the law. And it will support the government for e-governance and corporate governance basis. Basically, we do verification work to see the whatever is pending with the company and to comply with the requirement of all the pending forms, if any, within a period of the scheme, that is 30th September. And once 30th September is over, previous experience is that now the MCA is not considering to give any opportunity for relaxation of the scheme. Previous to scheme, they have not given any opportunity. Scheme close means close. So we should not wait for last date. Whatever is possible, do it fast. And once 30th September is over, our particular experience says that we need to verify whatever the document filed by the company under the scheme or otherwise the scheme. If each and every SRN is approved, then if there is a prosecution pending against any document, any company and its office director, then once you have filed the form, approved the form by the ROC, you will receive a immunity certificate that can be placed before the court for request for dismiss the case or closure of the case. Because immunity has already been given, then this case cannot be continued. ROC may be requested to proceed at their own. If company has made an appeal against any order of the penalty or adjudication, they need to first withdraw the application before filing of application for immunity. You can file document, there is no restriction to file document during the period of scheme, even though you have made an appeal against the order of adjudicating authority or competent authority. You can file, but before making application for immunity, you need to withdraw your appeal from the department and you need to provide an evidence to that effect in the form, because the form will ask you whether you have filed any appeal before the department. If you say yes, aa jayega mandatory requirement mein aa jayega ki file application for withdrawal of appeal. You need to take care only. The immunity shall be provided, the court has shall not be provided on the basis of immunity certificate provided to the court. द स्कीम शेल नॉट अप्लाई. बेसिकली एवरी कंपनी एक्सेप्ट इनको जो रहेगा, फॉर विच एक्शन फॉर फाइनल नोटिस फॉर स्ट्राइकिंग ऑफ अंडर सेक्शन 4248 हैज बीन इनिशिएटेड बाय डेजिग्नेटेड अथॉरिटी. हियर डेजिग्नेटेड अथॉरिटी मींस आरओसी. इफ द आरओसी हैज गिवन फाइनल नोटिस, हाउ वी कैन बी असर्टेन वेदर द नोटिस इज फाइनल और नॉट? सिंपली इफ योर स्टेट अंडर द MCA master data is showing under the action of striking off, you must understand that it is a final notice. Your name of the your company's name must be appeared in the list under section 248 at the portal of ROC. There is requirement to give public notice by way of gazette notification before स्ट्राइकिंग ऑफ नेम ऑफ द कंपनी. सेकेंड नोटिस के बाद में वो डालते हैं. तो इफ नोटिस हैज बीन पब्लिश इन द ऑफिशियल गजेट फॉर स्ट्राइकिंग ऑफ और सीकिंग कमेंट फ्रॉम इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट और एनी अदर पर्सन इंटरेस्टेड इन ये, देन यू आर नॉट एबल टू फाइल योर डॉक्यूमेंट अंडर द पर्टिकुलर स्कीम. आर योर कंपनी हैज वॉलंटरीली अप्लाइड फॉर टेकिंग एक्शन फॉर स्ट्राइकिंग अंडर सेक्शन 248 इन द फॉर्म नंबर STK2, then you cannot take benefit of this scheme. Or your company has already been amalgamated and your company status in the portal is reflecting as amalgamated, then you cannot take benefit, because once the company's status changed from amalgamated normal company or active company to amalgamated under the process of strike off or strike off, this company is not available for e-filing. When the company is not available for e-filing, you cannot take benefit at all. Basic. And where the company have obtained status of dormant company under section 455, if you have shown applied in form number MCS1 for change your status from active company to dormant company, other filing in your company shall not be eligible to be made. Therefore, there will be requirement or a vanishing company. Vanishing company means a company which has come out with the public issue past and during the last two years, no balance sheet filed, balance sheet and return filed to ROC, no return filed to stock exchange, your registered office of the company which is shown is not traceable, your director is not traceable, then this company can be categorized as a vanishing company. If it is a vanishing company, you cannot take benefit of this scheme. Further, that filing of form for SST1 for increase in authorized share capital will be out of the scheme. Form number CAG1, CAG4, CAG8 and CAG9 will be out of the scheme. This cannot be filed under the scheme. As we have already discussed, Deshpande ji, a parallelly two scheme is running, which provide no filing fee, additional filing fee, no additional filing. No filing fee is required to be paid, no additional filing. One is under moratorium period as per circular date of 24th March, and second is under the pre-registered scheme. Right? Two schemes parallelly operating. Under the CAG1, CAG4, CAG8, CAG9 cannot be filed under the scheme formed by SS7. Which is related to increase in authorized capital cannot be filed under the scheme, because it is related to payment of additional filing fee by way of interest at the rate of 2% or 2.5% depending upon the delay cost. CAG1, CAG4 is a form, is not a nature of general compliance. It is related to other matter also like IBC. If charge is registered, then register charge holder is having separate status in the COC or in claims once it is due. Then these are not supposed to be covered under the scheme, and for that purpose, if there is a default, you need to take separate other step. Like in case of CAG1, you can file for document up to 120 days, 60 days, and then 60 days thereafter, there is no scope to file the document, as you are aware. CAG,
right.
270 days, after 270 days, no scope. This type of, you can take immunity. But for the purpose of CAG1, if it is exceeding 120 days, no authority is given to file this form, so that it is not covered. What is the consequences? The charge holder will not be having status of charge holder, and their amount shall be liable to be repaid immediately. That cannot be provided by way of immunity under the filing of the scheme. So that this form has been excluded.
So two points here on this particular slide. One is in respect of companies who have received STK-1 form notices. That is not a final notice. So for them, this scheme can be, they can use this particular scheme before the STK-5 or STK-6 has been issued by ROC. So that possibility is there. And one more question which was posed by one of the members, that my company is already struck off. So can I go to NCLT, get my company revived before the scheme is open, and then pay the filing fee under this scheme? So whether it is possible to take that benefit if I go for a revival of the company right now under Section 252.
Devanji, your two questions. Number one, if the final notice is given, if first notice is given in STK-1, it is not a final notice. Final notice means STK-5. When STK-5 is issued, it is in gazette notification as well as simultaneously publication of name of the company in the portal of MCA. If it is final notice, then you cannot avail the benefit of this scheme. If your company is one step ahead, is strike up by the ROC, okay, then you are not eligible to take benefit until unless you revive the company under Section 252 by the NCLT under Section 252(1) or (3) as the case may be. Until unless you revive the company, you will not be eligible to file. Once it is revived, then all the pending document after filing of form number INC 28 to ROC, changing the status from strike up to active company, you can file each and every document, related document under the scheme. There is no restriction at all, but first course of action is to revive your company.
Right.
The mechanism. Okay. Another question may be, if company has already been revived, once it was strike up, it was revived, company has filed only benefit for a period of 3 years and rest of the 20 years could not be filed. Now they can file this 20 years benefit under this scheme. Even though at present they are very much comfortable, apni company to chalu ho gaya, apna to land bik gaya. Wo purpose pura nahi hua, department may prosecute you anytime. So it is advisable to complete with all the pending filings and to get your company as a clean slate and start fresh. If you are not having any business activities to do, even then it is advisable to comply with the requirement by way of availing the benefit of the scheme by filing a form. And you are having two options in case of your company is not active, means it is inactive. Either to go for strike off after making all the compliances, or to apply to change the status of the company from active to dormant company under Section 455. So that there should not be any further default in your company. Okay, sir.
Fine, sir. You can continue.
Then circular number 11. We have already discussed a lot about this circular. And there is a requirement in particular circular that the circular specimen, the detailed requirement is regard are being issued separately. I could not see the requirement which has been prescribed, which type of the forms to be covered and whatever. I think our question may be solved by way of this. If you go to the first pair of the circular, the last line says that circular specimen detailed requirement in this regard are being issued separately. We are waiting for that, and after once it is received, we will be having a clear mindset how to proceed. Now, in the particular circular number 11 dated 24th, it is a very good circular issued by the MCA. 60 days additional time period given for difference between two board meeting. There can be up to 180 days difference between two board meeting maximum. And if it is there will be no consideration of default committed under the provision of the Company Act. Now, cargo, I already told you that it has been extended. Then There is a requirement, there is a circular which provided a newly incorporated company are required to file declaration for commencement of business of within 180 days. Further 180 days has already been given. What should be the date? What should be date? Basically, this circular is aimed to consider the matter from the date of this circular, 24th March, from the due date, whatever is their due date, if the company was incorporated, if the company was incorporated in October 2019, 1st October 2019, then 180 days was completed on 31st March. Then from 31st March, 180 days further given. If the company was incorporated in July 19, 1st July 19, so 1st July 19 से मोटे तौर पे देखें अपन तो 31st March is the 180 days already over, 182 days. वहां से लेकर के आपको फिर से 180 days मिलेंगे. If my company incorporated today, or on 1st April, then it cannot be meaning of particular circular because 1st April 2019 to 30th September is the 180 days and 30th September 31st March 2021. I am having such much time. This should not be. From the date, last date, जिससे हुआ वहां से 180 days उन्होंने further दिया है. तो newly incorporated company, company to be incorporated is not there. Means the company which was already in existence on 24th March is eligible to get benefit of further 180 days if required. There will be another issue. Previously, I'm not having experience to file form number AOC4 now. Previously, if there is no minimum paid up capital 1 lakh or 5 lakh in case of private limited company or public limited company, form AOC4 is under scrutiny, while mark as a minimum capital is not there. If our 31st March is over, without having minimum paid up capital, what would be the status of how? I could not understand basically. There may be requirement under the particular requirement, if it's 31st March 2020, the minimum paid up capital is less than the minimum capital shown, irrespective you are having 180 days time, you need to comply with the particular requirement, that is, has to be checked. Then, now another interesting circular issued by the MCA, that is on 6 March, it is in suppression of the earlier circular issued on 17 February 2020. Basically, if, as you already said that I am IP as well as IRP, registered valuer and practicing company secretary, fortunately, unfortunately, whatever you say, I have not taken any assignment for IRP. Okay, so that I am not aware, much aware about the practical aspect of the IRP. However, I am author on a particular book, Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, I have two editions. So there was a requirement, basically IRP or RP are liquidated is required to comply with the, all the applicable laws, comply with the, all the applicable laws, including company law, not only company law. They are required to make compliance of the law. If the company is not in a position not comply with the requirement for 4 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, balance sheet has not been prepared or filed to ROC. Once he takes charge, he is required to make compliance thereafter. Previously, non-compliant, he is not supposed to be responsible. But thereafter, he is responsible. How to file the document when the director of the company is suspended? Their DSC cannot be used. Your DSC is not there, you cannot file the document. Physical filing will not be considered as the filing of the document. Even by listed company, if you need to file, you need to file only on the portal of BSE or NSE on a particular place, not otherwise. To come out with the protocol requirement, AMCA has issued a circular dated 6 March, which provide date. The order of NCLT in which your status has been recognized or appointed as the IRP or RP or liquidated, you need to file a form number INC 28 along with the copy of the order of the NCLT. And your designation for that purpose should be considered only as a CEO, Chief Executive Officer. Even though your responsibility being IRP or RPR liquidated will not change, you will be continue. But for the purpose of filing and compliance of the company, that you will be considered a CEO, right? So once you take order after 6 March, you need to file your document INC 28 to ROC. Showing your status as CEO, it will be accepted and filed. In case your company status will not change automatically, the for that purpose change of status from active company to under the CIRP, under liquidation, the IBBI shall make necessary application to IT sale of MCA and they will change the status from the normal company to MCD. The IRP or RPR liquidated as the case may be, shall be responsible to file form to ROC with their signature as a CEO, including form number AOC4, MGT7, whatever form except form number 28, INC 28, each and every form which is required to be filed by the company shall be filed by IRP with his digital signature along with the form number MGT2. It's GNL2. GNL2, it will be an attachment of form number GNL2 until the company is having status under IRP, under the CIRP. All the forms will be filed in GNL2 only, including form number MGD7 or MGDOC4, other forms, whatever is required to be filed. Basically, there is no requirement because company is required to hold general meeting. If general meeting is there, there may be requirement to pass a resolution, then there may be requirement to file form number MGT14 also. There may be change in the register from one place to another place due to technical reason or due to change in the location of particular premises taken over by the company. Then all the document required to be filed by IRP through GNL2 by way of an attachment, and he is responsible to make compliance. For the purpose of filing of this document, the date of board decision, yes, there is no board, board is suspended. The date of order should be taken as a date of board resolution. Okay. That can be complied. And all the orders received by company which is under CIRP are under liquidation before 6 March, they are also required to file form now with the normal filing fee. There will be no additional filing fee for the purpose of filing a form GNL2. By IRP or RP. Okay, sir?
Perfect, sir. You can go ahead.
Okay. You need to see that for every type of activities, for filing a form to ROC, you need to file for GNL2 separately for each type of, if there is requirement to file form number MGT7, AOC4, form number INC22, you need to file 3 forms. One form for one each activities. Cannot be consolidated one form file kar diya, sabhi to ho gaya, nahi. Separate form needs to be filed. The circular was desired basically, circular number 5 of the 22nd March. What happens if you are an independent director in a company, in case of company commit any default, by default, whatever name available in the portal of MCA, under signature, view signature status, they issue show cause notice to all the directors of the company, irrespective of your status, you are non in. Executive director, you are an independent director, you are not promoting, non-promoting director, I mean professional director, they start. Therefore, government considered looking into provision section 149 is a non-assistance clause which provided the liability of independent director, non-executive director, not being promoter or KMP would only be in respect of such omission or